Thank you for coming. I'm Nick Gillespie, editor-at-large at Reason, and I'm happy to welcome you to the Reason Speakeasy, a monthly conversation series with outspoken defenders of free thinking and heterodoxy in an age of cancel culture and thought police. Tonight's guest is the brilliant maverick Columbia University neuroscientist Carl Hart, author most recently of the controversial book Drug Use for Grown-Ups, Chasing Liberty in the Land of Fear. In a world where drug legalization efforts are on the march and the pernicious effects of drug prohibition on criminal justice, education, foreign policy, and racial and ethnic communities are being scrutinized like never before, Carl is breaking bold new ground on how we think about drug policy, substance use and abuse, and individual freedom. The Declaration of Independence guaranteed life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness for all of us, as long as we don't disrupt anybody else's ability to do the same, says Carl. That means we get to live our life as we choose, as we see fit. Taking drugs is a part of that for a lot of Americans. He writes that his use of drugs, including heroin and other substances, helps him be a better person. I do not have a drug use problem, he declares, never have. Each day I meet my parental, personal, and professional responsibilities. I pay my taxes, serve as a volunteer in my community, and contribute to the global community as an informed and engaged citizen. We're going to talk about all of that tonight, his path-breaking research on addiction, how he turned from an ardent supporter of the drug war to one of its leading critics, elitism within the legalization movement, and how he talks with his kids and his students, some of whom are here tonight, about responsible drug use. And we're going to have plenty of time for audience Q&A, so start thinking about that. You will be asked to speak into a microphone. You can give your name or a fake name if you prefer. That might be more fun. So get your questions ready. And now, Carl, welcome.
Thank you, Nick.
All right. So Drug Use for Grown-Ups, which came out last year, extends and deepens some of your arguments and points you made in your 2013 book, High Price. Give us the elevator pitch of Drug Use for Grown-Ups. What's its main argument, and what are you hoping to accomplish with it?
Yeah, first of all, I just want to say thank you for putting this together. Thank Reason. You're one of a few people who I actually interact with today. So I'm really happy to be here with you.
Well, thank you. That's very flattering. I question your your choice, but you're not hurting anyone. So.
Today is April the 4th, and it's about 7 o'clock. It's 54 years and almost to the minute that Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. He was assassinated about 6:05 Central Time in Memphis, which would be 7:05 our time here. And so almost to the minute, MLK was assassinated. And you asked about the book. And his sort of thinking and people like MLK influenced my thinking with this book. I was thinking about MLK, Fannie Lou Hamer, a number of my heroes from the civil rights movement, and their sort of constant harping on the Declaration of Independence. And I wanted to know, like, why? And so I had to reread the Declaration of Independence. They make us read this when we're like 12, when it's not relevant to 12-year-olds, because 12-year-olds don't have any liberty. Their parents tell them what to do. And then we don't ask Americans to read it anymore. And many Americans think they know what it's about, when in fact they don't. For example, the left has conceded the sort of principles in the Declaration to the right. And then the right, many times they want to control you and not tell you, really understand what it means. It means liberty for some people. Well, the thing that really influenced me about the Declaration was this idea of all of us are born with these three birthrights: life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, among others. And it says that they can't be taken away from us. And then in the very next sentence, it says something like, government should be created to protect or secure these rights. And when they don't, when they fail to do that, governments should be disbanded. And Americans don't know that. What that simply means is that we can live our life like we see fit as long as we don't prevent any other people from pursuing these rights. That's what it means. And so I thought about it from the thing that I had been studying for about 30 years, drugs. And I thought, like, why am I upset about people's use of drugs when someone like me giving these drugs to people every day in the lab, every day giving drugs like crack cocaine, methamphetamine, opioids, and other drugs.
I realize now I made a big mistake by not applying to Columbia, you know, but.
Yeah, thank you for clarifying that.
Yeah.
We give these drugs to research participants who meet stringent sort of entry requirements for the study, but the point is, the point is that we give these drugs to people, and we do so because of your tax dollars. And we do so in order to understand what these drugs do and don't do. We do so to help develop better treatments and so forth. But the point is that we do so without any untoward effects. And we've given thousands of doses of these drugs, and most of the people are really happy after they receive some of these drugs. And so it really got me to thinking about why are we so upset as a society? And we are upset as a society, not because of the drugs or the drug effects, but what we have said this type of drug use means and who's using these drugs. And so I wrote this book in order to show the public, the American public, the global public, that most of the people who use drugs, the drugs that we're concerned about, the psychoactive substances like cocaine, psilocybin, MDMA, heroin, you name it, most of the people who use these drugs are people like me. Well, not black, but they're mainly white. But they're middle class, and they are well off. They take care of their families. They're responsible people. They even sometimes become presidents because presidents have used these substances when they were in their youth. And I got to thinking about the fact that the illicit drug trade is a multi-billion dollar industry, which could not be supported by people who don't have money, meaning that the people who are using these drugs are people who have jobs, people who are well-functioning in society. And so I wanted to present a more realistic view of the psychoactive substance user. And that's one of the reasons that I wrote the book. Another reason I wrote the book is that I wanted to also kind of expose the hypocrisy as it relates to some of the claims that we've made about what drugs do. The sort of drug addiction is a brain disease model. I wanted to deconstruct that and present evidence to show how that's more myth than reality. I wanted to also help people to understand that the sort of policies, our drug policies, were not based on pharmacology, but they're based on our sort of racism, classism, and the rest of these sort of isms, more so than pharmacology. I wanted people to understand how with the so-called opioid crises, how we overcount the numbers in order to inflate those numbers. And so I wanted to show people how death investigations are done when it comes to drugs. For example, most of the people who die from these things called drug-related overdoses, they have multiple drugs in their systems, and the people who are doing the death investigations don't measure the drug levels, so you don't know which drug actually caused that effect. And then there are all other kinds of problems, like the people who are doing the death investigations are largely not qualified. There are people who are coroners, and the thing that's required to be a coroner is a high school diploma. And then you go to a place like California, the lead sort of death investigator in most of the counties is the sheriff. And so you see how these things, how the bias happened with these things. So I wanted to point out all of these sort of things. But most importantly, coming back to MLK, I wanted to show people, when we think about the effects of these drugs, the predominant effects of the drugs that we're talking about are positive. And people experience all of the sort of pro-social things that we say we value. Like, people become more forgiving, more empathetic. They become magnanimous. They become more forgiving. Just all of these sort of things that we oftentimes overlook when we talk about drug use. And so I wanted to also help people to understand that this activity requires a tremendous amount of responsibility. And most people exercise as much responsibility in this activity as they do with other activities in their life. Although that's not the story that we are presented in the public. So I think that's more than an elevator pitch, but that's
a pretty high elevator, right? So we're going to like the Empire State Building. Thank you for that. Before we go further, let's define some of your key terms. You know, your title mentions grown-ups. What do you mean when you say this? You're talking about drug use for grown-ups. You're not talking about drug use for kids, unborn children, you know, pets or anything. What counts as a grown-up?
Yeah, I wanted to make sure when I include a grown-up in the title, I wanted to make sure people who were less than genuine in this conversation wanted to make sure that they were neutralized. So one of the things that we do with this conversation, we prevent grown-ups from having this conversation by saying, what about the kids? Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to make sure that the what about the kids was not going to be the showstopper here. I mean, I have children. My youngest is 21. But there are activities in which adults engage. And they have children that they don't want their children to engage. And you can think about, you can have kids who are very young kids and you don't want them to engage in sexual intercourse. But you don't stop having sexual intercourse because you don't want
your kids.
What
about the children? Yeah.
No one's asking you about, what about the children? Why do you have your door closed? What about the children? Yeah. You know, and so, but we do that with drugs. And so I wanted to make sure that that didn't happen in this conversation.
So it's people who, you know, legal age of majority, but it's also people who can handle drugs responsibly.
Absolutely. So another sort of thing that I wanted to head off to was this notion about people who are having problems in life in general. I mean, some people who are having problems in life in general, particularly now with COVID, life is just hard in general. And some people just don't have enough practice with certain responsibility skills. And so they may mess up in this area or in this area. And so I wanted to make sure people understood that I was not speaking to the entire population. And so if I was going to think about people, for example, who are having problems in life because of co-occurring psychiatric illnesses, I would have to address all of those illnesses and the various nuance that come with them. And this book is not that kind of book. And so I wanted to make it clear, I was not talking about that group of people. Some people took it as me saying that you could only use drugs if you meet my definition of grown-up. No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that this is who I am speaking to. That's the only point that I... That's the point that
Can
I was
you
making.
Talk a bit about, you know, discussions of drug use, as you were pointing out, immediately conflate use and abuse. And, you know, we have, and I guess it's really after about 30 years of advertising campaigns to say, be a responsible drinker. That exists in our kind of collective unconscious. But then when you say, be a responsible PCP user, be a responsible weed user, this, we haven't quite got there. How do you define kind of responsible use or adult use and addiction? Like, because I want to talk with you about how you conceive of addiction in a different way than I think most of us have been taught to, and the way certainly the rehab and recovery system does. But, you know, just in a colloquial way. So,
yeah. So when I think of the way that I define addiction in the book, was the definition that we use in medicine and science. It's in the DSM, the Diagnostic Statistical Manual of the American Psychiatric Association. It's a simple definition. It's where you have these impairments in your psychosocial functioning. You fail to meet obligations at work, at school. You take more of the substance more often than you initially planned.
I feel like you've been reading my personnel file.
Exactly. That's one component. So you meet some number of symptoms. That's one component. But also, these symptoms have to cause impairment, significant impairment, or they cause the user to be distressed. And oftentimes, the people, when they're making this diagnosis or they're thinking about addiction, they don't do this second component, that it causes significant impairment or the person is distressed. So, for example, like me failing to meet an obligation that we typically have in the family, say like Thanksgiving dinner, let's just say that for example. In my family, I have some people who support Trump, and I usually go to Thanksgiving dinner. But since the Trump era, I don't go, and I'd much rather be using a psychoactive substance. Now, and I am not distressed by that. Now, now some people might say, you know, that, you meet this symptom, but right. No, the symptom has the cause. Distress or significant impairment, and clearly that doesn't happen. But that's an example of why it's so important to go to the second component of making the diagnosis. Now, one of the things that I talked about in the book was I wanted to make sure people understood that I wasn't talking about drug addiction. So, like, the vast majority of people who use psychoactive substance do not meet criteria for addiction, you know. Almost all of the conversation in the country surrounding these drugs focus on addiction. Whether you turn on your television set, some movie, some TV program, some TV series, in the media, you name it, it focuses on addiction, even though that's not what predominantly happens with these substances. So it would be like saying I'm interested in a certain type of German car, I don't know, a Mercedes BMW, and you go online to find out about these cars, and the only thing you find out about are crashes that happened in these cars. And that's what we do with drugs in our society. And so I wanted to make sure that people understood that I was not here to reinforce this inappropriate focus on drug addiction. That's not to say that people don't have problems with drugs, because some people certainly do. But that's not this book. Right. That's every other book.
Can you broadly talk about how, you know, why do people use drugs in a responsible way? You know, what do they get out of that? You know, and obviously that's a broad question, because different substances have different effects. People want different things at different times. But, you know, why are we drawn as human beings to altering our consciousness?
That's a question that anybody in this audience can answer. If you all have alcohol on your table, I mean, or if you took something before you came here, you do so in order to alter your mood or to preserve a mood state. And so it's a sort of simple thing, particularly when we think about the drugs that I'm talking about, cocaine, the opioids, MDMA, psilocybin, cannabis.
These are what the government calls illicit drugs.
That's right.
Which is fascinating, and you know, it's supposed to be kind of a medical conversation, but illicit is a moral term. They're not even just saying illegal. There's something sketchy about using
them. No, absolutely. And we want to be careful about even calling these things like medical terms, because we don't think of alcohol in terms of medical use. And we don't want medicine controlling people's sort of desire or ability to alter their mood. You never want, I mean, because medicine functions as cops. And in this sort of setting, it's like, why do you want to have go to your doctor and ask for a prescription for alcohol? That's silly. But that's what we are kind of asking people to do. And that's really silly when you think about it. And so when I think about the substances that we're talking about, why people take them, they take them for really to alter their mood, to feel better, to be more open, to be more kind, to have a different perspective, look at things differently. A wide range of reasons is why people take these substances. But notice, most of these reasons they're all pro-social reasons. We want to encourage this sort of thing in our society. You think about it, it's like, ultimately, people feel better. And so if you feel better, you're more likely to treat other people better. And that's one of the things that I tried to emphasize in the book. You know, it's really about me having to think about the impact of my behavior on the other people, particularly subordinates, and wanting to make sure I didn't somehow negatively impact my behavior that negatively impact a subordinate or people in my life. And that's one of the things that happens with some of this drug use, because I become more cognizant of other people in the world. And we don't emphasize that enough in our society.
So it's drugs, not hugs.
Drugs, not hugs.
Or maybe drugs and then, well, that could be problematic.
Well, I mean, you know, if you're with your significant other or people with whom you care, hugs are nice. I mean, drugs and hugs are nice, you know.
That's so true, yeah. Why not both?
Exactly.
You know, I also know, like, I don't drink alcohol anymore. I'm proudly, I guess, I only know people in my family back to my grandparents, and I am the third generation in a row to have a problem with alcohol. So I don't do it anymore. I take other drugs, and most people tell me I'm a better person for it, as you write about, which is like, you know, I mean, it's pretty gutsy. Even, you know, he's a tenured guy, so, you know, you really have to certainly fuck up in order to get fired. But, like, I know I write and read a lot about drug policy, and when a guy says, I use drugs, they make me a better person, I'm like, wow, I know that truth, but it's still kind of stunning to read that in print. So thank you for doing that.
Thank you.
What, you know, can you briefly sketch, like, at what point, obviously, intoxicants and mood-altering things are always kind of suspicious. And, you know, even in the Bible, there's cases where, you know, sometimes you're exhorted to drink, other times you're not. You know, Jesus made water into wine, so he obviously, you know, had some, you know, interest in altering his mood. But what's the origins of our fear? You know, you talk about chasing liberty in the land of fear. Our fear about the particular types of drugs that you're talking about? Because alcohol, alcohol's been around forever. We did go through a phase of prohibition, but, you know, when did it become, like, what are the roots of the drug war as we know it on the substances that you're writing about?
You know, some people they genuinely fear that if you take some substance, let's just say heroin, that heroin will just get a grip on you and you can't control it, and the drug controls your behavior. There are some people who actually believe that ignorant nonsense. I mean, there are people that believe that. And there are people who have used heroin who promote that sort of thing, in part because it's the only way that person could receive love from the society. Because if you say, oh, I once had a heroin problem, but I found Jesus, I'm okay now. And then now you're welcomed back into the society. It's the only way. You can't say that, yeah, I did do heroin every now and then, I'm good. No, I don't need your help, I'm good. Yeah. You can't say that in our society because of this narrative.
Was it always that way, or when did
start? No, I mean, you get to that, absolutely. It wasn't always that way. Associated certain drugs with groups that we don't like in the society. For example, we associated the opioids with Chinese who had come over to help build the railroads, and some brought with them smoking opium, and they opened up opium shops and opium dens, and people frequent those places, and they did well financially in places like San Francisco, New York City, and certain white businessmen were not happy about how well they were doing. They started to pass local ordinance that forbade white folks from going into those places, and they eventually tried to shut them down. And so that was one reason for related to the opium. You think about something like cocaine. Cocaine was quite pervasive in our society. In fact, Coca-Cola, they put it in the fountain drink and made a lot of money in places like Atlanta. And black people were excluded from the fountain, so it was really only available to white folks in that sort of setting. But then Coca-Cola bottled it, I believe in 1809, they bottled it. Now everyone has it in Coca-Cola and other places. And then you start to see these sort of negative reports associating cocaine use with black people, saying that black men they would put white women into slavery, prostitution. Black men, they said, were impervious to 32 caliber bullets. So you can unload your 32 caliber weapon into their chest, and they keep coming if they were on cocaine. And so it caused some Southern police forces to shift to the 38 caliber weapon. So you see all of these sort of stories that are built up around these drugs, promoting the sort of fear of certain drug use by certain groups. And I should say that this fear was not only promoted by like white Americans, it was also promoted by like black Americans and also some Chinese Americans, particularly those who wanted to be seen as respectable members of their community. And so this was just like today. You see all of these communities participating in the vilification of certain drugs. And so it didn't change. That's one of the things that I haven't done as good of a job of doing, is to show how all Americans participated in this sort of vilification of drugs and the people who, certain people who use these drugs. And so that fear then turned into this notion, to this sort of real event where people realized they can make fear off of this money. People like Harry Anslinger, he was the first bureau chief of the Bureau of Narcotics. He became the bureau chief in the early 1930s, and he stayed there until the 1960s. And he was the, Andrew Mellon's niece. He married Andrew Mellon's niece, and that's how he got that job at like 20-something years old. And he would say things like, cannabis made black people think that they were good as white people. And that was a fear kind of thing. But he also got his budgets increased by promoting this kind of fear. The Bureau of Narcotics was built up between the years 1932 and 1962. Right. They really got built
and,
up.
And he took over, I mean, he basically took a lot of the arguments about liquor or about alcohol prohibition and then mapped them onto
absolutely, because,
other substances.
Absolutely, because alcohol prohibition ended in 1933, right. And so they had to find a new hated substance, and he found cannabis. And so,
which was identified often with Mexicans, right, to go with the
Mexicans and also blacks in the South and also black people here in New York City, like Mayor LaGuardia at the time was trying to give some pushback to this notion of all people. Mayor LaGuardia in 1944 released his report saying that this is nonsense, what Anslinger is saying. But Anslinger saw very early that if you use this fear and attach it to drugs in certain groups, it could really increase your budgets. And this is what we have seen today when we think about the war on drugs and the propping up of police budgets and prison authority budgets. Also, even TV stations got a lot of money based on the drug war. So a number of people understand that this fear is tied to their pockets.
Yeah, I always think of the drug war. I mean, you think of it in kind of a small way, but it's shot through every aspect of our society. I mean, your kids, when they go to school, they get DARE. It's in our foreign policy. It's in our police budget. It's on TV. I'm old enough to remember video games where at the end of, you know, you would kick somebody's ass in Mortal Kombat and, you know, somebody would come out and say, real winners don't use drugs, which is one of the biggest lies that has ever been foisted on people, right? But and I remember there were urinal cake holders. So women, you won't understand this, but urinal cake holders that we would in urinals, I would say just say no to drugs. And I always wondered if the person who came up with that was secretly a legalizer, because it's like, you know, you're pissing on the idea of saying just say no to drugs.
It could have been a legalizer, but you got to also remember the people who were doing the urine testing.
Right.
They got a lot of money off of the war on drugs. In fact, they did like some of the first surveys that showed September 1989, in the United States, more than 60% of Americans said that the number one problem facing the United States was drugs. More than 60% of adult Americans, people who we walk around with. Now, in the face of homelessness, poverty, you got global, you got the global warming issue, you have all of these issues. And 60% of Americans said drugs facing the country was the number one problem. And that survey was conducted by the folks who were doing urine testing. And so they made sure that the American public were frightened about this. This is
maybe
after
they were saying that people didn't have enough drugs. That was the problem. I don't know.
That would have been nice, but what we saw with the people going to jail was different.
Yeah. We are having a different conversation about drugs now, right? I mean, and over the past, you know, you can start, I don't know when you want to say, like, the peak of the drug war, and I might be too optimistic, but we're having conversations about legalization. The House of Representatives just passed a bill to legalize marijuana at the federal level. It's not going to go anywhere, but it's a first. You know, is a legalization or kind of drug use for grownups, is this a conversation that America is finally ready to have? You know, that we're going to use a wide variety of substances to get where we want to be, you know, not just pharmaceuticals, not just booze, not just things like exercise and, you know, and yoga or meditation. What's driving that? Is it that we've opened up our pharmacopoeia and we reckon, you know, like in a world where everybody's taking Viagra and Prozac, does it make sense to say like, well, you know, maybe an opioid now and then or a psychedelic? Why are we more open to legalization than we were?
Well, I want to push back on the sort of optimism a little bit. Let's think about, since we're in New York City, let's think about Stonewall. Was it 69? Mm-hmm. Was it Stonewall was 69. And so Stonewall is where the gay community and the police clashed. And because the police were engaged in homophobic behavior, now, in 1969, this happened, where they were arresting people for being gay, essentially. Now, in 1969, today, it's different. You know, we still have some place to go. And I went to the University of Wyoming, where Matthew Shepard was murdered. Mm-hmm. So as I think about Stonewall, I think about Matthew Shepard, I think about those kind of things. It's like when we say, yeah, we made progress, but those people who are negatively affected by our stupidity and ignorance, they were no less human then than they are now. So just because we don't get it doesn't mean that somehow their humanity somehow was different. It wasn't. The same is true with drug users. Just because the society is having some moment where they want to talk about marijuana legalization, the person who's using heroin or MDMA or cocaine or something else, their humanity is still equated with my humanity. But just because the society doesn't get it and now they only want to talk about cannabis, I can't celebrate that. I have to think about that poor person whose humanity is not acknowledged at the same level as mine. And that's where I'm at.
But we are talking about, you know, legalizing plant-based drugs, you know, so mushrooms in places. We are MDMA.
We're talking about decriminalizing plant-based drugs, and we're talking about the legalizing cannabis largely at the state level, like New York, we recently did this. And we're doing so because we saw the tax revenue that were generated in Colorado and Washington and tax revenues that are being generated around the country. And so that's fueling this sort of legalization push. But since we talk about decriminalization, legalization, we should explain the difference.
Sure.
So when we think, when I say legalization, I mean just like what we do with alcohol or tobacco, and we're doing now with cannabis in some states, if you're of the right age, you can legally purchase it and you can legally sell it as well in shops and so forth. That's legalization. Decriminalization means that you, if you get caught with a personal amount, amounts that have been deemed for personal use, you won't get a criminal sanction or a criminal penalty, but you might get some sort of administrative fine or something. But you typically you wouldn't go to jail. And sales of that substance remains illegal, meaning that you still have to go to the black market and get substances that you don't know anything about the quality. So you still are putting yourself at risk in that sense. And also, you still give police a lot of discretion because in New York City, New York State, we decriminalized cannabis in 1977. But under many mayors, starting with Rudy Giuliani, people in the city were being arrested for cannabis and personal use, even though it is decriminalized. It has been decriminalized in the state since 1977. Same is true in Baltimore, where they decriminalized in 2014. Between 2015 and 2017, 1,596 people were arrested for simply possessing cannabis. 96% of those people were black because of police discretion. And so you see how even with decriminalization, these things get abused and people still suffer. And more importantly, people's lives are at risk because of tainted substances. And that's the most important thing. And that's why it's hard for me to get excited about people talking about decriminalization without even understanding the difference between legalization and decriminalization.
So what is the best way then to move conversations forward about things like legalization, where you're not only legalizing the use and the sale, but also the production? You know, how do we get there? Because it does seem broadly we're moving towards, we're having a better conversation about drugs than we were 50 years ago, certainly.
Yeah, shit, I was just born 50 years, not about 50 years ago, so that's not really saying much. You know, it's like, right? It's like saying, well, what? Interracial marriage was banned in many places 50 years ago, and they say like, well, now it's not banned. That's not much. That's not much progress in my mind. Or, and so when you say, how do we move forward? The only way I know how to move forward is to be honest in public and to call people on their bullshit. That's the only way I know. And this is not to necessarily embarrass people, but people's lives and health is at stake. And I have to remember that. And I know that I must treat people well, and I know that I must think of their humanity in the same way as I think of mine. Right. That's how we move forward. When we stop thinking of other people's humanity in the way we think of our own, we're in trouble. That means that there are some people, for example, who say, well, you know, I'm a physician or I'm a psychologist, whatever. I'm thinking about your humanity and I know what's best for you. I don't mean that. I mean, you equate people's humanity like you equate your own. That means that they are autonomous individuals and they can make their own decisions, even if those decisions seem to you not to be the most sound decisions, but that's not my role. Unless, you know, of course, there are other people being negatively impacted, and especially if that person doesn't think about other people, then I may have to intervene. But if not, it's not my business.
So, you know, part of your research looks at the, and you were talking a bit about this with addicts or people who would generally be, you know, relegated to a category of not being in control of themselves, not being autonomous. And you've done experiments with people who use methamphetamine, and you find, I mean, I think this is one of the ways of you allow people to recognize another person's humanity while they're making choices you might not understand, but that you found that giving small amounts of money to people or giving them the option of drugs or money, you found that people are making a wide variety of decisions that doesn't comport with that addict model where you're kind of a zombie enthralled to a drug. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. So at the core, I am a psychologist, a behaviorist at my core. And when you think about the principles of behaviorism, it's very simple. It's that there are consequences to behavior. That's it. And so if you can figure out the things we call contingencies, that is the consequences and the antecedents, the things that set up the consequences, then you can figure out how to alter people's behavior. You can control people's behavior, or you can understand why people are behaving in the way they behave. And so all we wanted to do was to show that drug-taking behavior followed the same principles as any behavior. So if you present a choice between something like taking a hit of a drug, whether it's methamphetamine, crack cocaine, and an attractive alternative, attractive being that it too can control behavior, or it's powerful enough to influence behavior, then you would see that a choice to self-administer a drug like crack or methamphetamine could be malleable, or it could be altered, it could be decreased if you simply have an attractive alternative that's potent enough. And so if you increase, if you offer something as little as $5 versus a hit of methamphetamine or a hit of crack cocaine, you'll see that they'll take the drug and the money about on the same number of opportunities. But if you increase the money to something like $20, they'll almost always take the money. I mean, because it just makes sense, and it shows that people who use drugs can and do behave rationally as the rest of us. There was a time when people said, "Oh, one hit of crack, you're addicted forever." Then they said the same thing about methamphetamine. Then they said the same thing about heroin. And then the cycle repeats. And then we go back
and
to these drugs.
You say that, you know, crack cocaine is the heroin of drugs.
Yeah.
And then heroin becomes the methamphetamine, and then yeah, it's a weird, vicious cycle. You spend a lot of time in Switzerland, which, you know, partly because of the way that they deal with drugs. And, you know, I don't think anybody here, I have not been to Switzerland, but, you know, it's not the first place I think of as, you know, this is the civilization that gave us the cuckoo clock and, you know, a really, you know, exact changing of the guards in front of the Vatican or something. What are they doing right about drug policy, and you know what should we be learning from these uptight Swiss people?
So you're going to make sure I can't enter the country anymore when I go back.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry about that. Yeah.
No. That's a good point. I mean, Switzerland, you know, in all seriousness, they managed to be neutral during World War II. You know, that's quite a feat when you So I'm not in Switzerland because they are they're so laissez-faire. I'm not there because of that. And there are some things about Switzerland that I don't like. I mean, they really follow the rules, like we can't flush our toilets after 10 o'clock at night or something like that. You know, it's or somebody might knock at your door with a 200-euro fine or Swiss francs fine. And so I am in Switzerland because people leave me alone. I live next to a park in Geneva, which is really lovely. In the summertime, you see teenagers out there anywhere from, I don't know, 14 to early 20s, smoking cannabis, having a good time. It's dark, doing alcohol, whatever. They have not a care in the world, and the police don't mess with them. And those kids growing up in that society actually know what freedom is and liberty and having a good time is. And so my wife and I, we just go to the park and watch the kids. just have a good time. And we think we, like, can you imagine this happening in Central Park without the police coming over messing with these kids? It's just a beautiful thing. We walk down the streets and prostitution is decriminalized. You see people, it's not, it doesn't look any way like it's untoward. It's people are kind to each other. The police are, they for the most part don't mess with people. It's just, they kind of leave people alone. And it's a lovely thing to just see people living and not fearing, like safety and that sort of thing. And this, the safety concerns I have in America are largely related to our police.
Mm-hmm. Let's, talk about psychedelic exceptionalism, because you're a critic of that, and you're actually more a critic, I think. I heard you talking with Ethan Nadelman, the former head of the Drug Policy Alliance, on a podcast that he has talking about drugism, where, you know, one of the things people still feel comfortable with saying, well, you know, we're all drug users here, but you do certain kinds of drugs, so I don't take you seriously. But there is within the broader drug legalization movement, certain people who are really into psychedelics will talk about how, you know, these drugs are special, these are unique, these are more potent, they're more powerful, and they can't really go into general circulation. You seem to be a critic of that model. Am I being accurate in your view? And where does that stem from?
Yeah. So one of the things I did in the new book was I came out as a heroin user, right? Also as a number of other drugs I said I use.
You were really going for the niche markets, right? Like, you know, it's like morning glory seeds, banana strings, everything. Heroin, yeah, of course. Throw that in.
Exactly. But I put heroin in the prologue up mm-hmm. front in order to align myself with the most vilified in our society.
Yeah, I think only juggalos, followers of the insane clown posse, are lower than heroin users.
Exactly. I did it intentionally, not that I'm some connoisseur or I'm an expert. You know, at some level, I feel like a fraud, right? Because there are a lot more, there are people who know a lot more about that substance than I do. Mm-hmm. But I align myself with that group because they are the most vilified. So I did it intentionally. And it's been an interesting thing in terms of the press that I've received. Because the press have tried to dismiss me because of it.
Right.
I said that I'm a regular heroin user. And so regular for me is, it could be once a month, or it could be once every 6 months, but just regular. That's all it is. But that phrase turned into, I shoot heroin every day. That's what that phrase turned right. into. And it's been quite incredible, because I thought that, you know, my accomplishments, if you really read them, who could argue with the accomplishments? Right. And it's like, who wouldn't want their child to, like, do this trajectory? Mm-hmm. I mean, and so I thought that that would be some protection.
Were you trying to get like a Wheaties box endorsement of, you know, I use heroin and I think you should too. You know? I didn't get to Columbia by snorting cocaine. I used heroin.
You would absolutely think that's what that would
right.
the way that it was yeah. it was reported. So it's been good that I had to experience this, because mm-hmm. then, again, it makes me be even more sympathetic, even empathetic towards those folks who are being castigated because right. of this sort of thing. And so when I hear people who are promoting their substance while disparaging another, It infuriates me, because clearly the person doesn't understand what is how drugs are classified. For one, many of the drug classifications are arbitrary, and it depends on who's doing the classifying.
the persons don't understand about dose. They don't understand about route of administration. They don't understand about setting. All of these things influence the sort of effects more than even the substances in many cases. And so it's maddening to see. It's important for us to know that folks who are opinion makers in our society, some writers, comedians, a number of people who have the microphone, they shape the opinions. And many of them, now it's cool to use psychedelics. And now that's sanctioned cool, which is bullshit. Sanctioned cool, that's an oxymoron. Right. But people don't understand that. They don't get it. People don't get it. And so being that group of people are touting the benefits of psychedelics. Right. Meanwhile, they are disparaging things like crack cocaine, methamphetamine, and heroin without even understanding.
So, this might be one of the reasons why you get a lot of pushback from within the drug legalization movement. I mean, this is a super radical position where you're not saying, I'm going to leave the power structure in place and I just want to put my stuff is now legal. You're saying I want to get rid of this power structure and stop having a hierarchy of, like malt liquor is not good. You know, wine is okay. LSD is okay, or mushrooms, but not heroin. I mean, that's the heart of your project, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Because, drug users in general have face this sort of prejudice. You know what it feels like to face such prejudice. And now you want to promulgate this, or you want to do this to another group. It's one of the more infuriating things that I face in my life, because I would think that people understand it's not right to make anyone feel.
But on the upside, now you have a better reason to take heroin, right? Because you're mad.
I don't really need a reason. This is the lovely thing about being your own man.
Yeah.
I do what I want as long as, I'm not negatively impacting other people's sort of experience or their life. But that's a lovely thing with being free.
Yeah.
So many people in our society don't understand what freedom is. And that's one of the reasons I wrote the book.
Could you demystify, on some level, I apologize for harping on the heroin, but I mean, it's a bold rhetorical move that you made. Demystify what it's like to use heroin, because I think most of us, when we think about it, if we don't have direct experience, or if we do, and I had a friend from college who became a junkie and died of an overdose in the kind of stereotypical way, found in a bathroom with a needle between his toes. It's everything from The Man with the Golden Arm up through Requiem for a Dream and all of this. But when you write and talk about heroin, it's almost like, it's a feel good kind of pleasant thing. And, it's not this horrific tableau.
I think people like William Burroughs and those guys, they really fucked it up. I mean, because, they were looking for a reason to be hip. Mm-hmm. And they were looking for things to write about that were on the edge. Yeah. And the dumbass society allowed them to say these things about heroin and be believed. Mm. It's really... The society got hoodwinked with those guys, and we still celebrate those idiots, And so if anybody has had, Vicodin, Percocet, you had some pain, that's an opioid experience. That's all it is. It can be euphoric, anxiety relieving, a wide range of those things. It's just that with something like heroin, straight heroin, real heroin, you don't have to deal with Things like acetaminophen in your Percocet, that's far more dangerous, can be far more dangerous than heroin if you take too much of it. And so if you've had an opioid for tooth pain, some other type of pain, then you've essentially had heroin. It's not a big deal. The reason why it's so mystified in our society is because of these people who wrote, who were looking for a life, who wanted to look like they were cool and interesting, when in fact they weren't.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, in Burroughs' first published novel under the name William Lee, Junkie, he talks about junk as a way of life. It's an entire set of associations that are far beyond anything pharmacologically he's talking about.
Yeah, I mean, they were frauds. I mean, it's annoying to people who are really cool, and you see these people who are...
Let's open this up to questions. Malik, can you ask people? Okay, yeah. All right. Raise your hand if you have a question for Carl Hart. And wait for Malik to...
I used to live in San Francisco, and it's turned into a dystopian nightmare driven by and large by the open opioid use and fentanyl use on the streets. I'm wondering, how do you address these sorts of social concerns?
Well, I used to live in San Francisco, too, and I was there recently, and I know the narrative. I mean, there are people who use drugs, and they're also homeless, and they are in those spaces, but this is not because of drugs. I think about a place like L.A., which I know the homeless population or those numbers better. There are more empty houses in L.A. than there are homeless people. The problem is housing, lack of housing, lack of ability to pay for housing. Our sort of simplistic way of looking at drugs and pointing to drugs as a problem that for why people are experiencing those problems in San Francisco, that's not it. The problem is related to the expense of San Francisco. I have been homeless once in my life, and it was in San Francisco. I had just got my PhD, moved from Laramie, Wyoming to San Francisco. I had to sleep under my desk, and I showered at the hospital. People didn't know because it was so damn expensive. And so this is the first time I'm telling that story publicly, but that's a fact. But we want to blame drugs for what the people in San Francisco are experiencing.
What do you do about people who clearly are not flourishing? You know, they might be homeless or not, but they have a drug problem and they resist treatment. You know, and I say this as a libertarian, like I don't want to coerce people into doing things, but you know, how do you as a, you know, either as a psychologist or as a caring person, how do you deal with that kind of situation?
Well, people who are not flourishing. So what we should do is maybe let the experts deal with this first. I'm not an expert in that area, and I won't. The reasons for why people are not flourishing, they vary widely. And in our culture, one of the things that's happened with these damn podcasts and the rest of these things is that everybody becomes an expert on everything. Oh, yeah. And so
I know a lot about structural steel and the level that jet fuel will or will not melt it, you know, and I became kind of an epidemiologist during COVID. So
exactly. And so this is the problem. We need to make sure that if you don't know what you're saying, shut the hell up.
Well, I don't know that we have a lot left to talk about then, but let's go to the next question, please. Malik?
Thanks, Malik. So in this discussion about difference between psychedelics and other drugs, we have to give credit to people like Roland Griffiths, who's done the research to help show utility of those agents for disease processes. It's sad that we don't have that being showcased for opium, right? Because, I mean, it was the first drug that we really learned to use well for treating pain and discomfort. But no one's looking at that anymore. Instead of that, that science is stronger than what Griffith's put out for psilocybin. And yet we don't say, you know, these are miracle drugs. The opiates were miracle drugs for saving disease. That was more of a comment. My real statement I wanted to ask the question about was, as a kid, we all, most of us first experience illicit agents when we're in our adolescence. And that makes sense because we're in our stage of exploration. How did you deal with it with your children in wanting to do that exploration as far as making them responsible during it? Because who wants to be responsible when you're an adolescent?
Yeah, and you are... You provide the ultimate instantiation of the old anti-drug ad. I learned it from you, Dad, right? When the kid the father finds his kid using drugs. And so how did you deal with that? And I mean, and the students here, you know, kids stay in school. If you're in Carl's class, stay in school. But how did you deal with all this?
You sound like a rapper now. One of the things that used to be in the old hip hop sort of PSAs, public service announcements, by the way, I used to be in that game for a little bit. I did some shows with Run DMC when I was a kid. And we all smoked some weed and together. And then I would see Run DMC on public service announcements saying, stay in school and stay off drugs. And I'd be like, what the fuck? Yeah. So that's who you sound like now. Back to this issue. When you said we should give credit to Roland Griffiths and people like that, yeah, I know Roland, and I also have done the science too. And you know, it's an interesting thing. It's really I've been hoping Roland comes out of the closet about his own use. I haven't seen him use or anything, but this is just suspicion. And it would do a lot more good. And you know, he's...
Could you explain who he is and why
I'm sorry, Roland Griffiths is a researcher at Johns Hopkins, and he, like me, does lab work with humans where he gives psychoactive substances and tests them. Roland has given drugs ranging from cocaine, nicotine, to psilocybin, and he has a long, impressive career. He's over 70 now, I suspect, and it'd be nice if he just came out of the closet too and just said, look, I'm responsible, I've been doing this, but he won't. I suspect he won't. And so when we are praising people, how about we see? Let's see first. Because I think that would go a long way to dispel these myths about what a typical drug user looks like.
Yeah, you talk a lot in the book about the chemical closet. And so you want like the Spartacus moment. People like, I'm Spartacus and I use heroin. I'm Spartacus and I use nicotine.
No. I want people to be out of the closet in their way. In their, you know, it's like I recognize that some people, they put themselves at risk. And of course, there's a lot of risk with what I'm doing. But when we started off the talk thinking about MLK, I mean, people like him who we admire, all of them put themselves at risk. That's why we admire them. That's what fighting for freedom looks like, putting yourself at risk. And so how people decide to do that, that's fine. I don't want to tell them how to do it, but they have to understand that, of course, there's risk. That's part of it. Now, back to the children. When I think about my own children, who by the way, were honor students, did well, we never talked about drugs, especially about drugs. Drugs were just like we never really talked about their girlfriends or the video games, anything that they could potentially, I don't know, have problems with. The thing that we emphasized was long-term goals. Mm-hmm. We wanted to make sure that they contributed to the society in which they were growing up. And so you take the sort of focus off of them and you put it outwards. Like, what are you contributing? What are you doing? And then their performance in school was like a marker. All right, if you're doing well in school and you're doing these other things, like they're playing sports, they're doing all these things that we asked, they got into the university that they wanted to get into, they did all of these things that we asked, that's what we focus on. And I should also say, my children, they came with me to the lab when they were young. They were, I don't know, since they were able to walk, they would come to the lab and see me giving a drug to someone, and we might have a conversation about that sort of thing. They had their birthday parties at the lab because we were poor, and that this was what we did. And so they were always at the lab, but there were no special conversations about drugs. If one is having special conversations about drugs, then you probably have lost the battle. This is really about just raising good, decent people. If you raise good, decent people and they're meeting all of these sort of things that you're requiring of them, that's what you want. This is, drugs are not special, and so we didn't want to treat drugs like they were special.
Another question.
Hey there. So thinking about like taking away the arbitrary classes off of drugs, from your experience, is there a drug or a substance that actually is more harmful for people or a society that we might not be aware of because of our prejudices?
Well, so my focus has been on drugs that are aware of, like cocaine, heroin, MDMA, psilocybin, those kind of things. So outside of those drugs, there have been drugs that have popped up in the society that were really dangerous and concerning. Oftentimes, these drugs pop up from people trying to skirt around the current legal regulations, the sort of prohibition on one drug. So I'll give you an example. In the 1970s and 1980s, people were trying to make synthetic opioids, and they were calling it things like China White. And then there was a compound that was promising. It looked kind of like Demerol, which is an opioid. But what happened was that the compound, some people call it MPTP, MPP plus, but it ultimately gets converted to MPP plus, by the body, and it selectively destroys dopamine cells. And dopamine neurons are important, particularly in the midbrain. They're important for movement. And you selectively damage or destroy these cells, you can have something that looks like Parkinson's disease. And so clearly, a drug like that is dangerous and should be banned. But when we're thinking about something like the actual drug that people were seeking, something like heroin, we don't have that concern. That's not an issue. As long as we have this sort of prohibition, the way that we're currently running our prohibition, we can expect to perhaps see some of these substances pop up periodically.
Is that what's going on with fentanyl, which is a very useful anesthetic, but it's being used for opioid or heroin, right?
Yeah, so something like fentanyl, which is an opioid too, fentanyl is slightly different. Fentanyl does not selectively cause damage to brain cells. Fentanyl, the concern with fentanyl is that it's so potent, meaning that so small amount is required to produce an effect. If someone thinks that they have something like heroin and in fact they have fentanyl, they may take too much and then overdose. That's the real concern with something like fentanyl. So yeah, there is a concern, but it's important for us to realize that fentanyl is an FDA-approved medication, and it's been approved for about 50 years now. And so fentanyl itself is a safe medication as long as the person understands that they actually have fentanyl and not something else.
So it's like Boys Town. There are no bad drugs, right? There are no bad boys, right? It's just, it's the context.
Context is important.
Malik, can we get a microphone up here for Charlie at the front table?
Thank you. Maybe you can clear up some misunderstanding or make me more clear about what your critique of psychedelic exceptionalism is. Is it simply that people who promote the use of psychedelics but then put down these other drugs are hypocritical? Or are you saying that drugs such as heroin or cocaine are as efficacious and healing and potentially transformational as psychedelic drugs can be?
I'm saying both. I'm saying that people who are disparaging, who are propping up psychedelic, not all, but some who are pumping up psychedelics, propping them up, and at the same time, they are disparaging things like heroin. And then if you really think about heroin, the effects, and you do it objectively, as I tried to point out in the book, heroin in a place like the heroin clinic in Switzerland, where people who are being treated for an opioid use disorder take heroin, they have those sort of transcendent experiences, some of those people with something like heroin. Certainly heroin can be that, depends on the setting, depends on the dose, depends on the experience of the user. That's what I'm saying. Absolutely.
So would you say drugs don't really have any inherent qualities or characteristics? Is it always the way that it gets used?
No, I wouldn't say that. Because, you know, the drugs have unique properties. You think about your cannabis experience versus your cocaine experience versus your MDMA experience. They have unique qualities. So I want to acknowledge that. But what I'm saying is that if persons are seeking, let's say, a transcendent experience, if they know what they're doing, they can certainly obtain that with something like heroin. But it might be more readily accessible to someone who has a tremendous amount of experience with psilocybin. So they do have their unique qualities, but they overlap.
Just as we're about out of time, and I just wanted to close on the topic. You were, and you've written about this, you were a drug warrior. And then you became a critic of the drug war. Can you talk briefly about what flipped that switch for you and what can society learn from your experience so that we become, you know, a better, you know, we become more critical readers of the information that we get about drugs and hopefully lead to a better set of policies and experiences with these substances?
Well, between 1984 and 1988, I served in the U.S. Air Force. And so in that period, 1986, the middle of that period, the country thought that crack cocaine, or the country was manipulated into believing that crack cocaine was the major problem facing the country. Even though crack cocaine use was always relatively low and never really approached anywhere near powder cocaine use levels, certainly nowhere near marijuana use levels or any of these other drugs. I got food like everyone else. In the Air Force, I was trying to think about how could I best serve my community. So I went to university while in the Air Force. And I was going with the notion in mind that I wanted to solve the drug addiction problem in my community. And so one way to do that was to study neuroscience and try to understand how neurons in the brain worked, try to manipulate this with drugs in order to treat people who were suffering from drug addiction. And I figured that if I cured drug addiction, I could solve some of the problems in my family, also in my community. And then, you know, that's what I did for the next 30 years, you know, wholeheartedly working in the lab, giving drugs to laboratory animals and humans. And along the way, the story just started to fall apart. I thought that most people who use these substances were addicted. Turns out the vast majority are not. You can't go to work every day and give drugs to people who you thought were irresponsible, People who you thought would not be able to show up on time, would not be able to follow direction. And you see this over and over again, seeing that this isn't true. And then reading the literature, starting to see how people would get a set of data, but didn't have a different interpretation. You can't be a critical scientist and not say, start to see these pieces, these cracks. And then over time, I start to realize how much money was being pumped into the war on drugs. I start to realize that I was a beneficiary. My PhD was paid for because of the war on drugs. I got $1 million of grants because of the war on drugs. And then I had to go home to Miami and see many of the males, my friends, my family members, gone, dead or in jail because of the war on drugs. I had to look at myself and think about my participation. All of those things helped me to change my mind. And then after writing High Price, traveling around the world, places like Brazil, and seeing that we have exported our war on drugs. And then at the same time, I'm being offered some of South America's finest cocaine and from some of captains of industry all around the globe. And all of these things cause cognitive dissonance. And then you have to solve the cognitive dissonance. And this is facing the truth is part of the way I solve the cognitive dissonance. Yeah.
As a final point, and this was, it was a real revelation for me, shortly after George Floyd's death at the hands of Minneapolis police, you wrote a piece in the New York Times, and this is, you know, this is like an instance of critical reading of something when George Floyd's toxicology report came out. You know, he had a bunch of different drugs in his system, and you cautioned in saying like that this data is almost completely useless the way it comes out. And I was thinking about that when the Foo Fighters drummer Taylor Hawkins died recently at the age of 50. He had a bunch of different drugs in it. What, you know, just very quickly, what when we see this thing come out, what should we be looking for as critical readers?
So tonight I have with me my seminar students. It's about 12 of them. They're here. And this semester seminar is focused on basically toxicologies and overdoses. And we're looking into the overdose literature, and we look at some toxicologies. So one of the things that it's important for us to do, whenever there are reports out saying that someone died from an overdose, if you can, get the toxicology, and then you will see drug levels in the person's systems. Oftentimes, the drug levels don't indicate that the person even used drugs in the past few days, because you know some of these drugs stay in your system for several days. But when we see what's reported in the media, they say, oh, he used methamphetamine, even though the levels are so low that it would suggest that the person hasn't used for at least 24 hours. So that's what I try to do when we have these high-profile cases in the media. I try to get the toxicology, and then we can look and see exactly what is likely contributed to the person's death. Like in the case of George Floyd, the initial reports were that he overdosed on fentanyl. And then if you look at the video, you see George Floyd was interacting with the police and interacting just like you would expect until they cut off his air supply. Right. They tried to say that it was the drugs. And so I looked at the toxicology. The levels of fentanyl in George Floyd's system were so low, it was highly unlikely that was the cause of his death. They also said something about cannabis and methamphetamines. Those levels were even lower. I just simply went through what was in his toxicology and tried to walk the reader through in a reasoned way. But even publishing that piece was really difficult because, again, medicine has been reluctant to comment on these kind of things. I think it's a dereliction of duty, quite frankly. And the police narrative is the only one that stands. And so in my class this semester, I'm trying to train people to know how to look at toxicologies. And so I won't be the only one in the public saying, wait a second, this doesn't make any sense.
Well, it's an extremely helpful article. Look it up. I want to thank Carl Hart. The book is Drug Use for Grownups, Chasing Liberty in the Land of Fear. Thank you for your work. Thank you for your service.
Thank you, Nick. Thank you, John.